The national memory of the Civil War has been so distorted by romanticism, heroism, and idealism that we've lost some of the major lessons from that terrible conflict. I will be covering the real cost of that war in blood and treasure, and the political, the social, and the economic impact to this country from that war. If you're taking the AP US History exam, if you understand those things, the political, social, and economic impact of the Civil War, you will do well on a major portion of that test. But I'm excited because today I have two guest speakers. One of them is Billy Yank. He's the first one, and he's from the North. And he's going to explain why he sided with the North and what the reasons are that drew him into the Union Army. The second is Johnny Reb. And he's going to explain why he decided to join up and fight for the Confederacy. Well, here he is now. Come on in and have a seat, Billy Yank, and explain your side and why you're fighting. Why am I fighting for the Union? First, for adventure. 15 years ago, we fought the Mexican War, and the War of 1812 was 35 years before that. So this is not an opportunity you get every day. My farm in Pennsylvania requires working long, hard hours, and I am ready for something different, like fighting side by side with my neighbors and old schoolmates. Besides, I figure the war will end soon, 3 to 6 months tops, because we have a lot more men and industrial might than the South. Since the Founding Fathers began this experiment in democracy over 80 years ago, the world has looked to us to see if this experiment in self-government could work. Pessimists in Europe have been predicting all this time that democracy was going to be a failed experiment. They said soon one person's idea of self-government would collide with another person's, and we would splinter and fragment, causing self-government to collapse in on itself. We cannot prove them right, so I believe in union now and forever. Behind me is Old Glory with its 34 stars. We've grown a lot in the last 85 years, and our best years are still ahead of us if we deal with these traitors and hold the Union together and then address our disagreements in accordance with the Constitution and the Union. Now, the thing we just can't have is for people who are unhappy because their man didn't get elected president to throw their toys down like children in a sandbox, throwing it down and just going home because they're not happy with the man who was elected president. Now, look carefully for a minute at the map behind me. That map shows the northern states in red, and it has the electoral college numbers that each state has, the votes that it casts for the electoral college. And as you can tell from the pie chart in the upper right-hand corner, 59% of the electoral votes went to Mr. Lincoln. So under the rules of our Constitution, fair and square, he was elected president of the United States. Now, he was our 16th president. 15 presidents we've had before Mr. Lincoln, and most of those presidents have come from the South or the border states, and most of them were slave owners. And a lot of the reason for that was because of this three-fifths compromise you've probably heard about, where slaves were counted as three-fifths persons for purposes of enumeration, for purposes of determining the political power of the South. And so we gave them and skewed power in their direction. And so when they elected presidents that we weren't that happy about, we responded and respected the Constitution and embraced those men as president. Now, what we expect them to do is to just simply embrace Mr. Lincoln as our legitimate president. But here's what happened. South Carolina. 1 month after Mr. Lincoln was elected president in November of 1860, 1 month after that, they declared secession. Now, they declared secession, but We don't believe they have the right to do that, and we're not respecting their right to secede at all. They've got to respect the Constitution and the fact Mr. Lincoln's a president. Now, a lot's gone on, and the other states followed as well, but you just can't get together in a democracy. The Confederates think that they're not going to have these same problems. If we let them split off, they may form a confederacy, but I can assure you, down the road, it's going to splinter and divide and everything else. Just as they want to leave the Union, they're going to splinter and divide. So, you know, we've got to put a stop to it. We've got to have one great nation and just work to get along. And they're not doing that. And we don't accept that. Now, what's our position on slavery? Well, first of all, at the very least, slavery cannot go beyond where it already exists. It can't move into the territories, and it sure can't be brought up north. But that's exactly what the Dred Scott decision did. The Dred Scott decision of the Supreme Court said, oh, by the way, you could just take your slaves anywhere in the Union, and that has to be respected. They're still your slaves. We hate slavery for a number of reasons, but the main reason, I gotta be honest with you, the main reason we hate slavery is because we don't want to compete with slave labor. If slavery were to go to the territories and expand, then when folks like me or my sons go and work in those areas, we've got to compete with slave labor. And slave labor does only one thing to wages, and that is it drives those wages down, 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 very low. It's just not fair, it's just not right for those of us who are white folks to have to compete with slave labor. It's just not right, and we're not going to accept it. And so the Dred Scott decision was a horrible decision. We just can't permit that kind of stuff. And slavery's got to keep from expanding beyond where it is. Now, there are some of the boys, and I've been talking to some of those boys from Massachusetts, particularly the other day, and they were talking about being for abolition, which seems a little extreme for most of us, but I could get used to the idea, I suppose, but for the most part, most of us just want to keep the Union together and limit slavery to where it is. And if we did that, we'd be mighty happy at this stage of the game, mighty happy indeed. Now, there's a silver-tongued devil coming up right after me. His name is Johnny Reb, and you got to watch him real careful. Good argument, good debater, good speaker, but you just got to watch Johnny Reb. So here he is, and he's been waiting here right next to me. Come on in and have a seat and take my place now, Johnny Reb. Three. I am Johnny Reb. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to explain why I am fighting for the Confederacy. I am here for adventure too, and I don't expect this war to last for long because one Southern gentleman can whip 10 Yankee rabble. But more importantly, Virginia is my country. This is where I was born and raised. I am a Virginian, first, last, and always. When we study the Constitution, we see at the bottom where the founders signed their names that they signed as representatives of states. Look at the signatures behind me. It was clearly the states that formed the Constitution. And I figure if the states can voluntarily join to form this country, they can voluntarily leave as well. To secede, to peacefully go their own way. Speaking of secession, isn't that exactly what we did to George III of England? Didn't we secede from England to determine our own destiny? We believe in the consent of the governed. We believed in it then and we believe in it now. We no longer give our consent to be ruled by the federal government in Washington City. And we want to exercise the same right to secede as the original patriots exercised when they seceded 85 years ago. That right to secede is absolute. That was our first war of independence, and we call this our second war of independence for exactly the same reasons. Although this time we are becoming independent from the Yankees in the North. Why do we do this? The state government is more responsive to the people than the federal government. Obviously, government at the local level will always reflect what the folks want more than a distant government in London, or Washington. A lot of these Yankees have a self-righteous attitude, by the way, about our peculiar institution of slavery. But let me give you the facts. There are free blacks up north and free blacks in the south, but they are wage slaves, essentially. Once they are paid, no one cares about them. If they cannot find work, if the economy hits a bad spot, why, they starve to death. Here is what you need to understand. Slaves are worth a lot of money. So we take care of them. We take care of our property. Our slaves always have work and are always given the basic necessities of life because they have value. Let's talk about the fugitive slave law now for a minute. It is right there in the United States Constitution in Article 4, Section 2, Clause 3. Go look it up. Go look it up. It's Article 4, Section 2, Clause 3. It's right there. And then on top of that, Congress passed a congressional act called the Fugitive Slave Act, requiring the same thing, a little more detail. Those Yankees are not abiding by the law that requires the return of our property. Many Yankees are even helping escape slaves. I mean, they're helping escape slaves get onto Canada on this Underground Railroad. I put a map up behind me on the Underground Railroad. And when they do that, we cannot ever get to them. We can't get them back. It's our property. They are doing this to our property. It's just not right. Now, I get so worked up about this sometimes. The Dred Scott decision was a 7-2 decision by the United States Supreme Court saying we could take our slaves anywhere in the country and they would still be our slaves. If the Yankees respected the Constitution, they would have respected that constitutional decision. But in these famous Lincoln-Douglas debates you've probably heard about, that Abraham Lincoln spent 2/3 of his time on those debates ripping on the Dred Scott decision. Slavery is sanctioned in the Constitution. It's protected in the Constitution. And the Yankees are not respecting that. We are not going to be part of a union that does not respect the Constitution, and that is why I'm fighting for the Confederacy. Well, if we can't persuade those Yankees through logic and the righteousness of our cause, then they will have a taste of Southern shot and shell. If they come down here in an attempt to destroy our rights and to make us submit to the Union, well, they will get the same response that the British got in this, our second war of independence. Weren't those two soldiers persuasive? I have to say, they both taught me a few things. They both went to war for adventure and to seek martial glory, something young men have pursued for all of United States and world history as well. Many of those young men returned in pine boxes, and as a retired Army officer, I have known some of them. Imagine how much harder war would be for nations to wage if young men were unwilling to embrace war for adventure, and if they understood the raw brutality of war. Johnny Reb was absolutely correct about the support in the Constitution for slavery, which is why Abraham Lincoln wanted to limit slavery to where it already existed. Abraham Lincoln realized he had no legal right to end slavery. Now, some of you may think that Billy Yank was pretty prejudiced on the issue of race, but we have to remember that social and political equality are two very different things. It was not until the 1960s, nearly a century after the Civil War, that Americans really began to think seriously in terms of social equality for all. That argument Johnny Reb made, by the way, about slavery solving the problem of unemployment, was made again in the 1950s and the 1960s by the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union argued seriously that communism was superior to capitalism because under communism there was no problem with unemployment. Exactly the same argument that Johnny Reb and many Southerners used to support slavery. Next, we study the cost of the Civil War. How do we understand the deaths of 630,000? Or how do we understand a national debt that went from 65 million in 1861 to $2.7 billion in 1865? That is our next challenge.